Hey everybody, Johnny Baja. Today I'm going to talk about the 1995 Baja 500. We did that on a 250R quad. It was a friend of ours, Denny Wolf. It was his quad that we used on that particular one. And we had a real good day. You know, all day long went real good. My job was to take it to the finish. It was probably, I would say roughly about a 3.5 hour run, something like that. My brother had taken the bike up over Mike's Sky Ranch and came down to Villa de Trinidad where I got on and took it out to the coast. Now you go out to the coast and head north and the race is gonna end in Santo Tomas. So when I got on the bike, everything was running good. We were in the lead at that time, but you don't know how much of a lead you're in, so you go as hard as you can. And when I got out to the coast, I was getting close to the coast. I was probably about 5 minutes or so from the ocean. And it was a lot of high speed roads getting out to the highway right before the ocean. And the course turned, made a hard left, and I was going wide open. And I took that thing a little too fast, and that whole quad spun around. And I was gonna do a spin or high side and come off or something. And I just stayed on the gas as hard as I could. And that thing did a high speed, basically a high speed, almost a 360, a little more than a 360 actually. And then off down the road I went, and I didn't come off it. I could not believe it. It felt like a once in a lifetime deal to be able to pull that off and not crash. And then about 5 minutes later, I came into a pit stop to get some gas where our crew chief Gunners was at, and just, you know, gave me some gas to get to my next pit. Took off out of that, went about 5 more miles or so, and I overshot a turn. And the desert in this was just a road through all this cactus. Those small cactuses are probably, I don't know, maybe 2 feet in diameter and about 1.5 feet tall. They look like big artichokes. I don't even remember the name of those, but the quad went up on those, and I didn't crash, I didn't come off, but I was on top of all these cactuses, all four tires on top of the thorns sticking up. So I'm thinking to myself, well, there goes all my tires. I'm gonna have 4 flat tires, and then I'm gonna get all poked and jabbed trying to get out of this mess. And luckily there were some locals that just, they kind of came out of nowhere. I didn't even know, I didn't see them when I was racing, but they came, they helped me muscle that thing off of those cactuses and get it back on the road. And I only had one rear tire. The right rear tire was, it wasn't just going flat, but it had a slow leak in it. I figured, well, I'll change that at the next pit if I need to. And I came out of it. I didn't get poked. I didn't get hurt. Everything was good except that tire that was half, you know, half flat, so to speak. So anyways, I get going, we're still in the lead. I go on up and do my racing, and I figure my next pit's gonna be back on the highway again. It kind of goes through this mountain range and then pops back out on the highway. And when I got there, I had radioed ahead and said, hey, I'm gonna need a flat tire and a spark plug. Things were kind of acting up a little bit. I felt I needed a spark plug pretty bad. And I came into that pit, went to change the spark plug, and all of our effort was going at that. That was the key thing. And then here comes first place. And I get the plug in, and then here comes second place. I'm thinking, oh boy, I've just been passed twice in less than a minute. So those guys were right on me and I didn't even know it. I knew who these guys were. One of them was Dean Sundahl. And the other guy, I didn't know him personally, but I knew of him. They were really fast. And I thought, you know what? I better just, that tire's been holding pretty good for a while. If I change it, I'm gonna be way back. I need to go and I'm gonna chance it. So I took off, and as I took off down the highway, we don't have to go down the highway for like half a mile and get back in the dirt. I see the first place guy that passed us. He was going backwards looking for his pit. And I'm thinking, okay, well, he doesn't know where his pit's at, or maybe they're not even there. And then I went, got back in the dirt, and as soon as I hit the dirt, I could see up ahead, there was Sundahl was up there on a Banshee. He was running a Banshee 350. We were on the 250 Hondas. And so he easily had us outpowered. Don't know how long he'd been on his section, or maybe he took the whole thing on his own, I don't know. But I determined that I'm going to have to stay right with him. If you get too far back, all you do is eat dust. You can't see anything. You're probably going to get hurt. So I got up as close as I could. And no way did I have the power to just go on around him. There was no way. He never looked back. The whole time I was behind him, he didn't look back one time. If he had and saw me there, he would have pushed even harder than what he was doing. So I stuck with him for a whole hour. And we went up the coast, and we came into my next pit stop. And when I got in there, I came into my pit, and I said, Gunners, where's Sundahl? He says, John, you're the first one here. I go, I just was with him. Oh, well. So he gave me a splash of gas, took out of there. I told him, I said, hey, let me know when he comes through here so I know where he's at. And it was a minute and a half later, Gunner got on the radio and said, hey, John, he just pulled out. So I knew, he knew that I was ahead of him, and he was just going to go crazy to try to get around me. Now, we were in two different classes at that time. He was in open class. We were in the 250 class. But when the leaders are up front like that, you want not only to win your class, you want the overall for the ATVs. So we both wanted that, even, you know, no matter what. So it wasn't probably 10 minutes later, I was heading in from the coast, and this road on this ranch, it hung a real sharp right. And when I turned right, I looked to my right, and there was Sundahl. He was right on me. And I'm thinking, boy, this is going to be the race of my life. So in my mind, I'm thinking, if he comes around me on this road, which is basically just farm fire road type roads with barbed wire and fences and everything, I mean, and you're in the dust, if you try to pass on a road like that, it's real dangerous. You better be careful. So I thought, well, I'm going to go as hard as I can. That's going to, you know, it's going to be hard to come around. But he's known for charging hard. So anyway, I pushed and pushed, and I was fully exhausted at this point. I mean, I'm racing as hard as I ever did, and started getting close to Santo Tomas. You come up on this bluff and then work your way down the mountain to the finish line right there. And, you know, I looked back before I came down the bluff, and I didn't see him. And I thought, he must have crashed in the dust or something. I didn't know. So I get down to the finish, and my crew, nobody's there. They're still driving around in the chase truck trying to come down to Santo Tomas to pick me up. So I finished with nobody I knew there. And because we start the race, we don't all start at one time. It's a staggered thing. So, you know, at the start of a race, one quad takes off, 30 seconds to a minute later, the next quad takes off, and then the time's all calculated out at the end to see who's the winner. Well, in that race, I had to wait 9 minutes. And if I could be there 9 minutes and no other quad comes by, that means we win. So it was a real nerve-wracking for the 9 minutes, because I'm thinking he's going to be coming down here. You know, I didn't have that big a lead on him. And even if he crashed, he could get up and keep going if that's what happened. Well, later on, it turned out we did win overall on that one. And rumor had it that he had actually locked his motor up at the top of that hill somewhere up in there before, you know, before you work your way down the mountain. I don't know if that's true or not. I don't know if he crashed. I don't know exactly what happened. We think it was a motor issue. But in any case, we got that thing overall, and we were real happy about it. So that's it for the 95 race there for the Baja 500. I appreciate you guys watching. We've got some real interesting stories coming up here, and I think they're worth listening to. Appreciate it. Thanks, guys.